So my name is Janine Houwing-Duistermaat. I studied actually mathematics in Utrecht, but then I got a little bit bored and I thought why not applying for a fellowship with the Erasmus exchange program, and I went to Copenhagen, and there they were very famous, they're still famous in survival analysis, biostatistics, and I actually liked that a lot, and so I stayed in biostatistics. And I'm now a group leader on statistical genetics in the Leiden University Medical Center and coordinator of this Mimomics project. I'm going to tell you a little bit about statistics. I think, as Gordon also mentioned already, but I have to tell you, I also don't understand his slides. Probably you understand his slides better than I do, because I'm not from have a background in chemistry, and I find these glycans very hard to understand. And he didn't. And probably I can understand that a little bit, but what I have very difficulties with is that he changes his techniques every time. So then you finally understand how these spectra work, and you start to understand the measurement error, and then they have another technique and you can start over again. So he can have a hard time with us, but we also have a hard time with him. So, but I think we agree all nowadays that statistics is important. It's relevant. We live in a data-driven society. We have electronic patient records. We have these omics data sets. We have everything on the internet. So we have so much data, and to do something with data, you need statistics. And then the nice thing from applied statistics is that it's multidisciplinary. So it's very you have to work with a lot of other people, and if you like that, and I do like that, then it's really fun. There's lots of variation in data sets and problems. I think it's challenging. Sometimes the data sets are really, in the beginning, you don't know how to solve it. You don't know which model to fit. And then thinking about it in the end, you hope you did a nice job. Oh, I have 2x multidisciplinary. Okay, so but this is what people still think about. If you search around the internet, you see this little by jokes about statistics, and not about glycomics. But I think statistics is not boring, and perhaps in the past you could say that statistics is boring, because at that moment in 1930. There were only linear regression models. There was not so much data. The data sets were very small. There was no computers. There were no visualization tools. So if you had to do some statistics, there was these labs where they had to do the computations by hand. And I think if you then do only statistics, that is really boring. But that's not the case anymore. We have so many models. We have so much data. We have computers, and we can make an endless number of plots and improve on that. There also has been a time when people thought, oh, we are done with statistics. We don't need any new statistics anymore. Biostatistics is over. You did all the work for us. Thank you, biostatistics. But go and do something else. Because they thought, we have all the statistics. We have all the test statistics. We have all the models. We can figure out what kind of data we have. And then we know which button to push in the program for computing the p-values. And then we have the p-value, and we can write our paper. So stop being a biostatistician and go to epidemiology or biology or something else. This actually appears not to be true. But this was the feeling 1980, but also 1990 when I started with my PhD. It was still there, at least in the Netherlands. But it also appeared not to be true around that time, because then there was already survival analysis where they had to take into account that at the end of a follow-up, not all the patients or subjects in the data had the event. Some had, and some hadn't, some were censored. But at that time, there was another disease where there was a disease, there still is this disease, but I want to ask whether you know which disease it is, where they also didn't know when the infection, when the person really get infected, and when the seroconversion took place. So they didn't know where they have to start measuring. And so they need to extend the survival analytic tools to deal with that. Do you know which disease I talk about? It's 8. Yeah. So it's still an awful disease, but now you don't die about on it, or you. But it's chronic disease nowadays. But in the 90s, people died about it, so it was an awful disease. And the statistics had nice problems because of this. And yeah, it became more important next to epidemiology. And it went on because then we get genetics at the end of the last century. And then especially the states put a lot of money in collecting data, measuring data, but also in developing methods. So they also gave a lot of grants to statistical methodology. And nowadays we have the observational studies where we try to, the epidemiologists start with it, to try to distinguish associations from causality in observational studies. But that's really a difficult problem, and progress is very slow, but the progress comes from biostatistics. The other thing is that people think statistics is too difficult, or difficult, or too difficult. That might be true. I think it's difficult. But it's not so difficult as mathematics, in my opinion. You need formulas, but not to the extent if you do mathematics. And the problem, at least in the Netherlands, is that you cannot study statistics. You do mathematics, and then you do statistics. That's what I did, and that's what most people do. But mathematicians, most of the time, they don't like probabilities. They want to have one theorem, they want to prove it, and that's the truth. They don't like uncertainty. And so if you put statistics in mathematics, you don't get many students to do statistics, and you have a lack of statisticians. So there's typically not one best solution in statistics, and that makes it difficult, but it's, I think, nice, because you have lots of discussions. And this is a cartoon I will tell you a little bit more later, translated, because it's in Dutch. But it was at the time, I think, 10 years ago, I think. It was that there was a nurse in the Netherlands, and when she was on duty, it looks like that more patients died, relatively more patients died, than when she was not on duty. And then there was a statistician, and he said, yes, that is seems to be true. Seems very unlikely that she is not involved. And then there was also other pieces of evidence, and actually she had to appear in court, and she was sent to jail. But all the evidence was weak. It was not only the statistics, which was not properly done, also the other things, other evidence was weak. And then, but this one professor of statistics, he did the calculations again and make a better models, compared models, and he said, now it's not that, it can still be that she didn't do it. And then also it appeared that the other evidence was not true, and so she she's free now to go where she wants. But then in the newspaper there was the joke about the statistics, not about the toxicology and all those other things which went wrong, but it was about statistics. The probability that all professors, full professors in statistics in will agree, that probability is probably very small. And this is another picture that, that sometimes people have the feeling, because there's no one solution, that people have the feeling, yeah, you can do everything with statistics. But that is, of course, not true. You have to discuss your assumptions with the applied people, with the biologists, with or here in this example of the nurse, with the judges. The judges should have asked more about the statistical model which was used, and the statistician should have been more interested in what can go wrong here, and should have explained all the assumptions he made. So what is statistics? I think data alone is nothing. If you have just data points, you cannot, and nowadays you have so big data, you cannot do anything with it. You need to summarize it and to get insight in this data set and in your summaries, you need to distinguish the signals from the noise, because this is also what Gordon already mentioned. There is lots of noise in this data. There's noise because of batch effects, noise because of different people measuring, or randomness. It's not always noise, it's also randomness. because of different persons, because of confounders. So you have to think and model it to distinguish noise from the things you are interested in. And statistics also provides then the uncertainty about your parameters and about your conclusions. And now further, I think there are a lot of names going on now, so we don't have statistics, we have also data science nowadays, we have data analytics. I think that is almost all statistics with something more. And there's also much overlap with machine learning, data mining, optimization, and bioinformatics. So statistics is relevant, is hot. It's not only because of all this omics data, it's also because of people have less money. If you read an If you have followed the pharmaceutical industry, for example, they have not been able to make much progress in new treatments, only small progresses, and they are lacking in money. And these clinical randomized trials, they do to compare medicines and to check whether medicine really works. These are really expensive. So pharmaceutical industry have less money for clinical trials, so they try to get evidence also from observational studies. And then you need the statistics to distinguish association from causality. They also try to make the clinical trials more efficient. So they have these adaptive designs where they change the rules along the trial, which was forbidden in the past, but nowadays it's allowed. But it asks also difficult statistical models to deal with it. Now, then we have all this big data, now all these data sources available, and when we start modeling, we have to take into account that these data come from different sources, and that they are not the same. Just like different patch effect, different, all this heterogeneity we call that we have to take into account. And then this novel data set, as I mentioned, Gordon measures every time new, using new techniques, he has other data sets, other error structures, and we have to model that appropriately. The same, for example, with epigenetics. Epigenetics is a fraction, so you need other methods for to model that than models for glycomics. And then finally, I think big data is really a new challenge because I will also give you a lot of the basic lectures for basic statistics in the next 2 days. And actually, all the assumptions we will make there, they might not hold in big data. Well, they hold in, they have every, always these assumptions hold. There were almost no situations where they didn't hold. And now with the big data, due to randomness, they don't hold anymore. And so we need a new machinery to deal with big data to have valid inferences and valid conclusions. So, data is important. This is a talk about the value of data. So it's important to have good data and to also discuss this with statisticians so that you can get everything out of your data. It's important in healthcare, and there was even last February, I think, a call in Nature Genetics for papers to write on using old data but to give more insight in the data set. So data analysis is getting more and more intention in the literature. So what is my job in the LMC? So I'm heading a statistical genetics group, but we are also with other biostatisticians. We have 9 staff members. And the biggest job actually is giving service to the hospital. And in the past, it was always the clinicians. So it was just 2 of us, the statistician and the clinical researcher. Nowadays, we have to deal also with chemistry or with biology and the clinician. So it's larger groups, or also a bioinformatician and a statistician. So the groups leading the projects become larger. So it takes more time. But we are heavily involved in teaching, in the medical students, biomedical students. We will start with the University College in The Hague next year. And we have a master in statistical science, where we teach our own students, which we hope that we can recruit PhD students from. And then, of course, we also do research. But this research is always motivated, or preferably motivated, from the projects we are working on with the clinicians or with the biologists. Like Mimomics is such an example where we have research in statistical methods, but it's motivated by my collaboration with Manfred, who is the similar expertise as Gordon, but then in the LMC, and my collaborations with clinicians and epidemiologists. So I have two research lines. I actually started with analysis of family data. There's my PhD in. And then I'm still working on that because there's now interest from social sciences. I'm working on outcomes like social anxiety disorder. It's very hard to get people in there because they don't dare. But okay, they want to collect families and they want to estimate shared environmental and genetic effects. And better, and all is better to understand. They want to achieve a better understanding of this this social anxiety disorder. Is it environment or is it genetics, or both? Then we have now several variants, genetic variants identified, and then we want to use the family data to estimate what is now the probability that you get cancer if you are carrier of such a variant. And then all this novel omics data set that is part of Mimomics. That's my second. But let's go a little bit back in history where genetics started. I think genetics started with Mendel. He lived from 1822 to 1884 in Austria. And he studied the inheritance of several traits in pea plants. So he studied, for example, the color of the flower, the shape of the seed, the color of the seed. And he did all kinds of experiments, and he figured out that actually there should be two copies of a gene each time. And one copy you got from your mother, and the other copy you got from your father. And then you transmit one of those copies to your offspring, and this goes randomly. So each copy has the same probability. That is actually his first law. He also made a second law, and where he said that also the traits are independently segregating. So he said that he thought that if you have color and you have the form of the seed, the shape of the seed, then this will be independently distributed to the offspring. And that appeared not to be true. So Bateson and Punnett studied inheritance of flower color and shape of pollen grains. And they did an experiment where they showed that it's actually that the big P and the big L's like to stay together, and the small P and the small L's like to stay together. So what was the experiment? He had homozygous PP, big P, big L lines, and small P, small L lines. He crossed them, so he had heterozygous lines, and then he crossed these heterozygous lines again. And then if everything mixed up randomly, then you would observe these numbers. But then it appeared that these P, big P and the L stay together, so you have more of them. And also the small P and the small L stay together, so you have more of them than under expected. So there was, they said, a kind of linkage between genetic loci. But they didn't understand how it worked. And that endured until Morgan, because Morgan proved that the genes are actually grouped in chromosomes, and that if a gene is on the chromosome, two genes on the chromosome together, then they tend to, the alleles of these genes tend to segregate together. But still, there can be a mixture of genetic material, and that is due to crossover. So if you have the red is the chromosome from your mother, and if the green is the chromosome from your father, then, for example, the egg cells may have a mixture of a chromosome where the first part is originally from the mother and the second part comes from the father. So there is exchange in, there is crossing over, but it's not independently. The closer the genes are at the chromosome, the more they tend to segregate together. So, and then one final big guy, that was Fisher. He lived from 1890 to 1962. he actually also studied mathematics, but he's really famous because of his contributions to genetics and to statistics. So he also did a lot of experience himself. He was for a while he worked at a laboratory where they did these experiments. And he also did a lot. So for example, the likelihoods, all these ideas around likelihoods, they came from him. And ANOVA, group testing, those kind of things, is all from him. He all developed that. So it started with the linkage study with Fisher. And then Gordon mentions also, we went on with genome-wide association study. So linkage study, you only need to measure about 7,000 SNPs to give you a number. And then you can do a linkage study in a family. For genome-wide association study, if you saw this plot of Gordon with the many p-values, it's about 500k to 1 million or even 3 million data points, depending on whether you impute the data or not. Whole genome sequencing is really you determine all the variants on the whole chromosome. You really describe the whole chromosome. You measure all variants. So that was the genetics, and the fun nowadays is that we are more interested in the environment. What does if you have a genetic variant and you have a certain genetic variant and in a certain environment, what is the effect? And in addition, we have the genetics, we have also epigenetics, transcriptomics, metabolomics, glycomics, proteomics, and also I will get in the near future my first imaging data sets. So this is actually trying to come closer to the biology. Genetics is nice because it's fixed. You have the allele or you don't have the allele. But although it has been successfully to identify a lot of loci, they don't explain the biology, the underlying mechanisms very well. So what the ongoing development is really to measure these in-between data sets, the glycomics, the proteomics, and to make the link from the genetics via these omics data sets to the disease. So, and this is also one of our motivating studies for my project, which I do together with Mar. We don't do this data set, but it illustrates how we work and how multidisciplinary it is. So we have in the LEMC, there's a study in the LEMC. We here have proteomics, but Manfred is also involved, so we will also have glycomics, but the first data set will be proteomics. These are cancer patients, and they are had surgery, and they were declared healthy again. But after they had the first cancer event, they were in the screening programs. They entered the screening programs, but then these screening tests, diagnostic tools, are not so good still. So they want to improve it, and they want to make it easy for the patients. So they want to find changes in protein which can predict that the cancer that there is a recurrence event of cancer. So what they do is if a patient had surgery, they come for screening to the LUMC again. They take a blood and they put it in the freezer. And then they do that over the time, and at a certain point I think we have now about 70 patients who had a recurrent event. So he had cancer again for the second time. And we have lots of patients, I think about 300, who don't have yet a recurrence. And we want to do the statistical analysis we want to do an experiment in the statistical analysis to identify changes in protein which predict then a recurrence of cancer over time. So but we can't measure all those healthy patients, so we only take a subset of this. So the first question is, which subset do we have to choose? Now, I think we have talked about it for 3 hours and we decided on that. It's a little bit technical, so I will not tell you how, but that is epidemiology, how to make the design of the study. Which controls do you choose for your cases. But then we have, so we have decided that, and now we have to arrange them on the plates. So as Gordon already mentioned, that it's very important how to arrange the data on the plates, because you have effects, you have batch effects. So each plate acts different. So you have to think about whether, if you have longitudinal measurements, if you have plots of the same patient several times, should they be all on the same plate or should they be on different plates? So it's plate design. So that is where we still, my colleague is still working on that. And then we can measure. So then about mimomics. So in mimomics, we do glycomics and metabolomics. This is a new leaflet. It's not printed yet. It will be sent to the printer next week, I think. So this is it's quite big. It's 15 partners. And Genos is in there, and Pharmatics is in there, and Athena is from Pharmatics, and Yuri is in there, and LEMC is in there. So it's quite fun to work with all those institutes. So we, because of all those institutes, we also have lots of different expertise, from statistics to networks. Networks is sometimes statistics, is also sometimes more physics. It's also something on the border. It's machine learning, epidemiology, and also infrastructure, because we have this big data set and we want to work on the same data sets together. So we need a server, we need to get access, and it needs to be safe. So, and what we want to do, we want to identify, using all these omics sets, so metabolomics, glycomics, genetic data sets, to identify profiles which are associated with clinical endpoints. So similar for the proteomics, but that is only proteomics. This one is more complicated because we want to combine multiple omics data sets. And the goals are actually that we want to improve on the whole range. So we want to improve the experimental design, we want to improve the statistical methods, and we also want to improve interpretation by having this multidisciplinary team. Okay, then my last two slides, I think, or three slides, are a little bit about our research project. So that will be me, but I have to leave Saturday. And Mara, she will arrive Tuesday. Mara is my postdoc, she's from Spain. So it's very international here. The idea is that we will study the impact of the experimental design on what you do afterwards. So we have two data sets. One data set is very well designed, and another data set is badly designed. I think it's on the next slide how bad it is designed. Yeah, this one. So here we see it's not well designed. We have a plate, we have two control sets and one case set, and we see that on this plate we only have this control set. But on this plate, these two plates, we have only a few cases. Well, here we have, so this is not nicely designed. And if you do it like this, then you lose money. You lose money, you lose time, because we will also try to correct for batch effect, and some programs won't work anymore because it's so badly designed. Other programs will work. So it's if you do it like this, it's a waste of money, it's a waste of time. And for the whole research, and it's good to think about it. So what we will do is we will steer the impact of experimental design on how good you can model the error structure of the batch effects, how it affects the interpretation of data, what you can conclude and what you can't conclude, the efficiency, so actually waste of time, especially waste of money, because your confidence intervals are larger if you have not a well-designed study. Flexibility, because you cannot do all models anymore if you didn't take care of the beginning. And we do that by using these two data sets and by also do simulations. So this was designed. So I think this is a relevant topic because our project starts from the beginning. This is all projects start with design. And if you do this beginning good, that will always help you in the end. So a good design, more insight in the outcome, more efficient. And if you are more efficient and you do everything well, then you have more time for interpretation, more time for trying another model and getting more out of the data. And in our project, we really start with the design, I think I told you already, and we end up with the interpretation. So we do the whole range. So, and we are all from different countries, and I heard already Ivo saying, I like or I don't like the Dutch with the lunch because they eat peanut butter and chocolate, only a sandwich. I think here in lunch we have a lot of meat. And probably you all have your own favorite lunches and dinners, and you discuss that and tell us what you like. But when you live with Gregor Mendel, there was only one thing you could eat afterwards, and that was peace. Okay, thank you. That was my presentation.